My name is Paul Debevec, and I am the Chief Visual Officer at the University of Southern California's Institute for Creative Technologies. And most of what I do is run a computer graphics research group there that's looking at creating the next generations of virtual reality, digital characters, and 3D displays. The biggest goal of our group is really to have impact, to do what we can do that would be most valuable for furthering the state of the art in all the things we're working on. For example, photoreal digital characters. And these are areas that are also of interest in various ways to various forms of industry, to video games, to visual effects, to even medical simulations. And what we try to do is find research problems where if we come up with a solution to it, it'll move the ball a little bit further forward. And then to have impact, the best thing you can do is actually collaborate with people who have got other parts of the puzzle, and you put them together and you see what you get. And we're always motivated by research, but then we want to take it, you know, one step further into actually being used so that we can learn the lessons as to whether it's really valuable and also set up what's our next research problem, because we still haven't gotten that part yet. You know, one of our best collaborations that we had was the Digital Emily project with Image Metrics, and that was all R&D, non-commercial project, but we got, you know, one of the earlier photoreal-like digital characters from that. And more recently, the Digital Ira project with Activision, which has turned into a blossoming collaboration with them as well. Some of the work that we do in the lab is, you know, people can hire us to scan faces. We have a technology licensee, Otoy, which runs a commercial light stage in Burbank. People can hire them to scan faces as well. So this is something that you know, provides a little bit of revenue for research. But the most important thing is it actually gets us in direct conversation and working with, you know, the incredibly talented people out there in industry who are looking at the problem from different directions. And it's those kind of conversations that really inspire what's the next thing to do and how can we take this even further. Often the question is asked, have we made it past the uncanny valley? And I think the answer to that is yes, we've made it past the uncanny valley a few times, but they've been like moon missions. They've been expensive, they've been experimental, they've been a little dangerous, but we've gotten there and returned safely to this earth a few times. But we haven't set up a moon base at this point. We don't know how to just reliably, at reasonable cost, create photoreal digital characters without worrying about, is it going to come out well or not? And that's where we need to advance the technology to. Photoreal digital characters are extremely useful in the case of interactive entertainment, where you don't know the camera position before, you don't necessarily know the lighting the character will be in, and eventually you'll be using AI to animate the characters to, you know, actually be spontaneous and say things that are responding to the game action in ways that aren't, you know, specifically scripted. So for those things, you're actually going to need to have digital characters. They're also extremely useful, as we found out, in film projects as well. And for those, you know, they've been very successful, and they've helped they've helped movies tell stories that would have been difficult. Curious Case of Benjamin Button couldn't have been made with Brad Pitt in just older makeup. It wouldn't have looked realistic enough to believe the character. And there's no way it could have gotten nominated for 13 Academy Awards if it hadn't, you know, actually brought the audience in and gotten them to believe this. So when you're recreating somebody's likeness, which you can do for someone who's alive, ideally you could scan them. If it's someone who's passed on, then you need to put a lot more effort and artistry into it. But we've seen that, for example, in the Billboard Music Awards. There was a quote-unquote hologram, not a real hologram, performance of Michael Jackson, where it was a digital Michael Jackson. He never was filmed giving that performance, and it was believable. People seated in the front rows actually responded to it as if this is like a Michael Jackson performance and assumed it was like some unearthed video. That's very eye-opening. It was difficult to do, and they actually had to get people who knew Michael Jackson involved in figuring out how to keyframe animate that performance. But as it turns out, the level of human talent and the quality of tools that are available have advanced to the point where you actually can do this kind of thing. You know, it would actors don't need to worry that somebody's going to go and put them in a movie that they had no control over, because they actually do have rights to their likeness. And if they don't want to be represented digitally, they don't have to sign over their digital rights to anybody. There's some worry that, you know, once you've passed, people who own the rights to your estate might, you know, use you to sell vacuum cleaners or whatever it could be. I think that's a legitimate concern. I think there was an article that said that Robin Williams put in his stipulations as he passed that he will not be, you know, created digitally in any way. So, you know, he has the clauses for that. So hopefully just the legal system handles this all in the right way and things won't be done against people's will. What I think is important to note is that when somebody's gone, they're gone. And all you have left is what they left behind of their recorded performances, their interviews, anything they wrote, the photos, the video that there is of them. And it's usually a voluminous amount of material that any given member of an audience would only be familiar with a little bit. So I think that by, you know, recreating an actor or personality, you're never going to create anything truly new about them because they're no longer there. It's anything new you create wouldn't be them anymore. But it can act as a window into their greater body of work, and maybe interpreting, you know, their mannerisms or their voice, how they would say a line, you know, in a different context, some of which is imagined, but some of which channels what they did leave behind. And that can help make it more accessible and, you know, to newer audiences. Well, I've had a pretty good seat to watch all of this happening because one of the other directors at my institute, Professor Mark Bolas, is a pioneer in virtual reality. He was a keynote speaker here at FMX. He had developed a number of the best lightweight, wide field of view VR headsets over the years and ran them at the Institute ever since he came in the mid-2000s. So I've gotten to be in his systems and do head-tracked VR, and it's been cool. There was a young fellow who contacted him a few years ago who is a big fan of VR, very interested to learn more about it, and Mark said, well, hey, why don't you just come on over and work here, and hired a fellow named Palmer Luckey as a lab assistant and worked with him for about 10 months. And at about the end of that, Palmer wanted to do a Kickstarter because he thought, hey, I think I can really sell this thing to the gamers. And Mark wished him well on the whole thing. And that became Oculus VR, which got bought by Facebook. And then it just turned everybody's radar into, hey, this could be a really cool thing. And I think the cool thing about VR is, you know, first of all, because, you know, Steve Jobs wanted to see sharper text on the iPhone, willed into existence the Retina phone display, pixel densities that nobody would have thought, you know, whatever, I can read it, you know, with like 10 pixels across a letter. No, Steve Jobs wanted 25 pixels across a letter, so it looks sharp. And all of a sudden now you've got this little screen which is low cost because it's in millions of cell phones, and if you put a couple magnifiers there, you can turn it into, at the very least, you know, a kind of digital viewmaster. And wait, the phone also has like this inertial motion unit in it too. So wait, you could adjust the view there. And wow, VR is like only a couple $100 now at this point. The thing that really made it turn on though is the head tracking. And is, as the story goes, Oculus VR was working with Valve software. With a Valve's head tracking system, which is what's become the lanterns in the HTC Vive. And the demo that actually, from what I've been told, that got Mark Zuckerberg really excited about VR was a combination of the Oculus Rift headset and the head tracking system that was put together from Valve. And as a result, what happens is you move your head around in the scene and the motion parallax just makes it look like it's there and it comes alive, and you finally get that thing that you're not like staring through a porthole into another place, but that you are in that other place. And that's like an exciting thing. It's like you've transported, right? And we haven't had transporters before. It's awesome. So there's definitely something there. I have no idea how big this thing is going to be. We thought the Microsoft Kinect would be a big thing. Well, it was a big thing. It wasn't a huge thing. It hasn't completely revolutionized every game. We're not playing Call of Duty by dancing around in front of our couch. I think that VR definitely has an opportunity to affect gaming. I think games are going to be really fun and immersive, and things can dial up to 11 so much more in virtual reality than they can on just a screen in front of you. I think it'll be very useful for a lot of industrial tasks, for education. I love the idea of teachers being able to guide students through historical places or watch recreations of historical events as if you were really there. That sounds pretty awesome. My own group's interest in VR, it's certainly there. What we generally do is we're content creation tools. We digitize faces, we scan materials to get the right kind of glints and reflectance off of, you know, real world materials into games. But you know, in VR, everything is automatically 3D. If you want to make something look like there's a hologram, you know, on your table, you don't have to think of some crazy way to build a hologram. You can actually just render a hologram and it's like it's there over the table. We did do a project recently with some collaborators at Otoy, which is the company that's licensed the light stage technology. At last SIGGRAPH, Otoy demonstrated light field rendering for VR. And that was really exciting. They have the Octane Renderer, which is a very photoreal digital ray tracing global illumination system. It's very fast. And they created a render node for it that basically outputs a light field, which means it's basically taking a whole volume of space and pre-computing all of the rays going through that. So what happens is you have a very complex computer rendered scene that there's no way you could render in real time at the 90 frames per second you need for VR. You can still experience it totally in real time with all of that head tracking, forward, back, left, right, up, and down, because it's been pre-rendered as a light field data set. And it seemed like a very natural connection to that would be, how can we get photographic reality as a light field into VR? Because there was a disconnect in that all of the live action material that was available were either just 2D panoramas that you could look around in, or, you know, for the better stuff, 3D stereo. So you've got like a parallax between your left eye and your right eye. But the real world content doesn't react to you moving around like this and seeing all of the perspective shifts. And that's actually a stronger cue to the 3D of the scene than your binocular stereo. It's actually a much stronger cue. And that's what's that amazing sense of presence. So how could you make people feel amazingly present within a real world scene? Well, you have to record it in a way that, you know, records more of what the light's actually doing. You could certainly just take a 2D panorama and project it out onto 3D geometry and move around in that. But that's not going to get all of the life of the materials and what things are made out of and the translucencies and the glints that you see when you really move your head around. So I helped Otoy out with a little project, realized there was a pretty efficient way to shoot a light field using standard panoramic photography gear. Called up my friend Greg Downing, who's a VR photographer, and he happened to have a really nice pan tilt mount for a camera. And I asked him, can we, instead of putting the camera like you normally are supposed to, like right in the center of the mount, can we put like a bar down the middle of it, put the camera at the end of the bar? We got to counterweight it with something. It ended up being another camera, because it's the same weight, and we had an extra one. And we had it, instead of shooting a nodal, you know, panorama with a narrow lens around the nodal point, put a really wide angle lens on the camera, and then shot, you know, 72 images around and 24 up and down with massive overlap, but all from different perspectives. And that actually shot an absolutely perfect spherical light field, basically with existing equipment plus, you know, a rail to put the camera out there. And one of the things I had some fun here at FMX was the opportunity to demonstrate showing some video of the first time one of these data sets has actually been put into a VR headset and showing what it looks like when you move around in a real scene, and all of a sudden the reality of being somewhere else, because you're actually somewhere real, not rendered, comes alive. And we're looking forward to hopefully doing a lot more stuff with that. FMX is incredibly relevant to so many, that's what's amazing about it. So, so many different kinds of people who come here, all who are interested in, you know, film, visual effects, animation in some way, but anywhere from the technologists to the artists to the people who do the business, there's lots of people like that here, and they're all talking about what they do, and they're all talking to each other. And that's incredibly valuable, particularly artists talking to technologists. You know, John Lasseter has the famous quotes about, you know, how technology inspires art, and art inspires technology. That's really what happens here at FMX. And it's amazing, because in this little bubble of Stuttgart, Germany, things that are happening in the world of, you know, visual effects production and game development real things happen here because these people are, you know, collided together, and at the speakers' dinners, they have chances to really substantively interact with each other, you know, form real friendships and lasting relationships. So when you come here, it just feels like you're home, and the ball moves forward. And you go back, and then you take on projects, and you know, the opportunity to think that you might have something to talk about at the next FMX is a big motivating factor. Let's put something together that's going to really, you know, impress people and live a little bit more of that dream that I think we're all trying to get to.